walls and for many years over the years. In the general sense, it reminds me of 17th century Dutch painting in that, not that it looks like it at all, but it's called cornucopia, and it's about the largesse of food. You know, we've got plenty, here it is. And this is food that's so absolutely related to Jan and John's experience. So Jan was pointing out some things to me that because it's very abstracted in ways, but it's also very specific when you begin to see what's involved there. So you want to talk about that a little bit?
Well, probably the most abstract, on the left, underneath a craft picture on the far left, those half circles, ovals, those are eels, which are very edible. Native American eat those a lot. We taste almost everything that we come in contact with, but it's not in our regular diet. You can recognize all the different kinds of clams in there, from the very large cockle to the varnish clam to the little ones down at the bottom that could be any clam that you like. The clams off to the far right, the squiggly little line, he often used that to represent water or lightning. But in this case, we called it the lace. It's the little...
This is right beside the central, the big central...
Yeah. Point to it, right? Point to it.
Yeah. That?
Yeah.
To the right of that big picture, right there, where you're pointing.
Okay, I see it. Yeah.
The line that is sort of burgundy color, and it goes down.
Yeah.
He used that to represent water, to represent rivers. In this case, in a clam, when it opens, is a lace. It's just wonderful. You can't clean a clam without eating it raw. It is delicious. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, that's represented in there a couple of different times.
Mm-hmm. More clam-like than clam.
Yeah, it's very tender, very sweet, very delicate. And he's showing that big gray clam in the center, he's showing that twice, three times. We always called it, you know, the lace. It was beautiful.
Mm-hmm. And it also is the form that he used to represent water in many that kind of ogival that
right.
has a lot of natural form ramifications for
little oversized on the crabs, right?
The crab is right above that.
That's right. Funny, there's the crab right there.
There's some kind of a worm looking thing that's pinkish way over on the right hand side.
It could be a kelp worm. It's actually something we didn't taste. But fishermen use those for fishing. And all the wildlife in the bay, of course, they're always searching for edibles, and that would be something if it came up where they could grab it, they would. Etarts Bay right now has 16 geese that I watch on a regular basis. I'm always telling neighbor here, they came in about 2 months ago in two different sets, but almost together. Four in one, some over here, and they come and go together, but not together. They leave just, you know, 2 minutes later than the other. They get out of the bay, they don't really sit together, but they're not very far apart. So they kind of figured out. It's amazing. And when they come back, they do the same thing. We had our own water system until 3 years ago, and what was our water system, the water, fresh water, is coming out into the bay, and they sit on each side of it, mm-hmm. and don't cross it, and they go like that at each other. Mm-hmm. The natural world is our world. All of our world.
This, to me, brings up the idea that John, so he was all inspired by the natural world, but he also was an artist, and he looked at other artists, and both contemporary and artists of the past, and really absorbed that too. this has a lot of Marston Hartley sense to me, and I know he liked him. It's really instructive to look closely at these paintings, because what he's doing, John is an absolute master craftsman, I think, in every way. So he's always very sensitive to what the surface of the painting is doing. That's on canvas, but it's a very pebbly canvas, or a very pebbly surface, so I think he probably, you know specifically what he did there?
I'm not sure what he did.
There's something
I think he rolled a very nappy paint on first to get the texture, and then a lot of the water area is just scumbled in there. Mm-hmm. It has a very beautiful luminous sense to it, but very, very thin paint on top of very textured surface. And a lot of the joy of looking at his work, to me, it has to do with that really seeing and sensing what he's doing with surfaces. Let's talk about the big one a little bit. So this was inspired by it.
Yeah, called Simplicity. And back in the day, when I pretty much was sewing all my clothes, and a lot of us did, a lot of the wives of art school students would gather around. We did a lot of sewing. But he saw these patterns, and he wanted to look through my pattern box to see if there was anything that he could tear up and use. So this is Simplicity somewhere on it. That's the title.
Simplicity.
It's the name of a pattern company. Oh. But he very carefully, artistically drew all those little sewing lines that you see around the edge of all the black. Mm-hmm. And
black on white.
Patience is what artists are, right? All of you.
Mm-hmm. And what is to follow through with this business about surface? When you're writing, I can even see it from here. The whites, in fact, all of the surfaces are collage. So they're layers of paint, layers of paper which have been glued in and painted over, and maybe another layer glued in and painted over. So you're getting a kind of texture like an ancient wall or something. So you get that kind of hit off the too. And it's not a matter of just, I don't imagine that pattern, some of it you would use that way, but I imagine that I can see in looking at it closely that he's collaged. Yeah. It's not just the way it would be from the pattern. And then the matter of taking, as Jan says, these doing those tiny little stitches over and over again. It looks mechanical, but it's not. It's all done by hand. And the overall image, to me, suggests a kind of fallen monolith or a big stone sculpture of a figure that's fallen
that's
on its side. Like a head on one side and the rest of it like shoulders and stumpy legs.
Yeah.
But that's just my reading of it. But I think it's in there somewhere.
That's great.
So what other ones do we want to talk about? The one behind the desk is particularly beautiful, I think. And it's representative of his interest in Japanese prints and the whole Japanese culture. And I think he saw that culture as being part of the Pacific Rim. So he's very interested in Northwest Indian, the Northwest Indian culture, which suffused the land long before we came to it, but also the ancient Japanese culture. So he's kind of including that in his general philosophy, I think. The papers, you've done a lot of thrift shop diving, or whatever you call it.
You couldn't avoid it.
Yeah.
Yeah. lot of the Japanese ended our papers and he's
right.
scrounged that way.
They're actually rice paper books that are, I'm going to say, pretty much 7x10, 5x10 size. And they're pages out of the book. The books are hand-stitched. They're about an inch thick. Mm. Some have some drawings. Most of them are straight calligraphy. And they're not an entire book. They've been, you know, tore up too. Mm-hmm. But you certainly enjoyed layers. You have to admit.
Layers and layers and layers.
And layers.
Looks like it was done at the same time, maybe. Do you think it was done at the same time as this
I don't know what the year on that
little,
is.
Well, it has a little structure
this,
to it.
This one is much more current. I can tell you that. I don't know the exact year, but I know it is much more current.
Interesting.
He did quite a number of paintings that are based on sewing patterns.
Right.
And some of them have more painting back into them,
right.
brush painting.
This is the only one that's left in the estate. I always liked a lot. If you're the seamstress, you know about A bodice from, right? A is the title of whatever that piece is, and the bodice front is the lady's front. And that is horribly in the focal in the collage.
One other thing that really strikes me about that one, it certainly is a representation of his interest in layers and open layers. You know, the black line on top appears to be a very free line, mm-hmm. and then you look at it up closely, and it can't be drawn with a brush. At all. It's got very crisp edge to it all the way through. So it's thick and thin, but it's absolutely flat, and there's no brush end to any of it. Mm-hmm. Even when it gets to the end where it's kind of angled to it, it's apparently cut in some way. So again, one of the things that often is intriguing about artwork, I think, is to look at it and not be able to figure out really how the damn thing was done. Louis Bunce used to react to things that way. He would just admire the hell out of something that where he couldn't figure it out. how it was achieved.
And then say, what the hell was that anyway?
And say what?
Then what the hell is that anyway?
What is it?
Louis was a dear friend, I can say that.
I want to bring up a couple more points. One of the things about John's studio that was interesting was that the etching press was right out in the middle. So he painted against one wall, and the press, as opposed to a lot of people that do painting and printmaking, the press would be way over on one side and to be mostly out of the way. But John really, his whole approach to painting was through, not exactly through printmaking, but printmaking and painting were really one thing to him. And he was constantly on that press, doing monotypes, starting paintings, revising works on paper, and improvising. So he would ink up pieces of paper, glue them down to the previous surface, run them through the press. The press was very important in getting this all to be very flat, and also sometimes the embossment that he was using had to do with the press. But the press, in my mind, most of John's paintings and prints are all one thing. It's not that you can say, this is a painting, or it's a print. It's all one sort of way of working and attitude toward art, which also has a lot to do with nature, I think, because nature is full of layers, leaves falling off trees in forests and piling up, and bark that builds in layers in the tree, and in the sea, things decay and fall down to the bottom, and you've got layers and layers and layers. Snow in the Arctic, layers. So I think there's a very wonderful connection between the way he worked and his attitude toward nature. So I want to say one other thing, and that is when I was thinking about John and nature, the name of Jackson Pollock came into my mind, because he said famously, "I am nature." And I wasn't trying to connect it with John, I just thought of that, and I thought, well, that's a very broad, it's a handsome statement. It's a one that's so broad that you can really feed meaning into it in a lot of directions. And then I thought, well, of course, there's nothing else about John that's like Pollock. And then I started thinking, well, let's see. Pollock was born raised on a farm in Wyoming. And did a lot of hunting and fishing in his youth. And he came to New York as a painter. He married Lee Krasner. They moved from New York City out to Long Island on an acre and a half. And they had a big vegetable garden, and they supported themselves from this vegetable garden for a long time when they were desperately poor. And then, as Pollock was saying, well, I am nature. I don't have to look at nature. It's kind of what he was saying. But there are writings where it says how he and Lee Krasner would sit out on the back porch in the evening and absorb the trees against the sky and so on. So it was seeping into his. Into his artwork. The other thing is that it was 2 years after he moved out to Long Island that he did his first drip painting. So being back in nature for him was a great kind of emphasis. And then finally, this whole thing about layers and overlapping. Many of John's paintings have a very openness to them. So they're layers, but they're not sort of solid layers. One, you know, it could be like a solid yellow, and I'll paint some blues over that solidly. They were always lacy. They were always the kind of thing that you could look into and down into. And so that you have the feeling that there are layers moving back in away from you and creating a kind of spatial quality. I think this is very much what Pollock was doing, particularly in all of those drip paintings, where you're always aware of the porousness of that surface. So, as they say, not to draw a too fine a line on it, which I'm doing.
Oh, yeah. We danced from, you know, every weekend that we could, Friday night, Saturday night. Mm-hmm. So in our house, table would be shoved aside, and friends would come, and that's a dance tune, and they'd grab John, and they'd dance around the stove.
That's great. Yeah, he did love dancing.
Yeah, he did. And he didn't dance when we got together. My family were the dancers.
Oh. What was that? He didn't dance.
He did not dance.
Why?
My family did the dances. Well, I think it had something to do with he was brought up in a tight Christian grandma. They didn't dance.
No.
Although, well, five children.
And after he left.
There was something going on.
After he left home, he got naughty.
Well, there was a lot of time in between there, but my family were the dancers. I danced on my father's feet ever since I could remember. That's how he taught me to dance.
Mm-hmm.
stand on his feet.
Wow, that's good.
So, yes. He played the accordion, so we had a lot of music in our house.
Well, it's about 1:15, so probably let people get up and stretch their legs.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for coming.